Welcome to the course on your ability to change. Today's lesson is going to be about the ability to change, which is going to dive into how to create a culture of innovation during a time period of chaos. Next, we'll get into how to actually spot evolving consumer needs and identify new opportunities, particularly when the environment is chaotic and different from the markets we were in before. That's going to lead us to how you would methodically and adaptively innovate in a different way to navigate chaotic territories. And finally, you might have a great idea, but if you're not able to break through all of the noise, then you're not going to get the buy-in you need internally, the end consumers, all that wonderful stuff. So without further ado, we're going to dive into the ability to change. Chaos causes organizations to retreat, but not always. And if you joined us for the last learning session, you probably noticed a huge list of companies we explored and talked about who were actually founded during periods of global economic recession. These time periods are interesting because chaos creates opportunity, chaos changes the rules, chaos reshuffles the deck. It switches who's in the lead and leads to what we call chaos-induced recharting, which is the concept that we go from a world that is path-dependent into a period of crisis like we're in right now, which leads us to a period where things start changing around in a predictable way. We use the word chaos, but chaos is in fact predictable, and if you're able to spot new consumer needs, you can rechart the path that you're on. So we went through last time these four different phases, and in today's series of lessons, we're going to dive a lot deeper. In fact, we're going to dive five whole lessons deeper with the content that first started off with my big career break, which was Exploiting Chaos, a book I'd written a dozen years ago. It was timed right around the market, sort of uncertainty. The market collapsed, and suddenly I became the chaos guy for hundreds of different brands, and I learned a lot from each one. And I didn't know if that was going to be the most relevant book topic, but in March I republished it as Create the Future in the Innovation Handbook, updating with all sorts of lessons about chaos that I'd learned over the last dozen years working with so many wonderful brands like each of you. So we're going to dive in the series, the five-part series, into five different sets of lessons that are all mapped against the framework that is in Create the Future and that we use for our future festivals. Today's lesson is going to be about the ability to change, which is going to dive into how to create a culture of innovation during a time period of chaos. Next, we'll get into how to actually spot evolving consumer needs and identify new opportunities, particularly when the environment is chaotic and different from the markets we were in before. That's going to lead us to how you would methodically and adaptively innovate in a different way to navigate chaotic territories. And finally, you might have a great idea, but if you're not able to break through all of the noise, then you're not going to get the buy-in you need internally, the end consumers, all that wonderful stuff. So without further ado, we're going to dive into the ability to change. Those of you who are at Future Festival in the last 6 months have seen a lot of this particular section, which is about the seven paths to path dependency. And if you're brand new with us, this will be all new, and the next four lessons will also be all new. So let's dive into the ability to change. Now, the lesson I like to kick off with, this story to capture your attention, is about horse dimensions and spaceships. Now, those two things might seem unrelated, but they are more related than you might think. In fact, as a clever innovator, as an analytic person, you would maybe expect that there should actually be horses in space. And in fact, if you're very clever, you would expect that there are two horses in space. And if you're interested in horse dimensions, which not everyone is, you would tell me that you would expect those horses to be 4'8.5" wide. This whole thing seems like I've derailed you. Why are we talking about horse dimensions in space? But it's for a purpose, because that width of two horses is the width that was used to determine the width of NASA's solid rocket boosters. And that might seem pretty weird. If you want to fact check it, you're going to have to go back pretty far in time. And what you're going to learn when you learn about horse dimensions is that in the Roman Empire, the Romans had the biggest empire because they patrolled that empire with the two-horse Roman war chariot. The war chariot allowed them to have the biggest land and territory, but it tore up the little highways of Europe, creating ruts on all of the little dirt roads. And if you were a little farmer and you drove your wagon through those ruts, you might break a wagon wheel. And if you do, if you did, you might be a little bit upset, and you would make your next wagon more carefully by, if you're clever, measuring the width of the ruts in the road. And you'd learn that those ruts are 4'8.5" wide. So pretty soon everyone is making wagons the same width as the Roman war chariot, 4'8.5" wide. Next up, we get wagonways, which are carts pulled by horses in and out of the gold mines, put on tracks that are 4'8.5" wide. Europeans invent the first train tracks and they put them on tracks that are 4'8.5" wide. Pretty soon Americans come out with their own trains and put them on tracks that are 4'8.5" wide. There are some bullet trains in the world that go 200 miles an hour on tracks that are 4'8.5" wide. And so when NASA needs to ship the solid rocket boosters from Utah to Florida, they must put them on tracks that are 4'8.5" wide. Now, if you fact check me, you might tell me, oh, but Jeremy, the width of the solid rocket boosters overlaps the width of the track, but it doesn't change the fact that the width is determined based on the width of two horses' butts. Now, that might seem a little bit wild. How does that happen? And yet it goes to show us that we're in this weird sort of world where that width is stupid. We're probably worse off for it. But in the space that we're in, we're more dependent on our past decisions than we like to think. We want to stick to the rules, the best practices, the common standard. And as a result, you can end up making things for outer space based on Roman war chariots. Everyone wants innovation to happen, but most people don't break from the path. And that's why our first lesson in the Chaos series is all about how to make change actually happen. Here we are enduring crisis and even chaotic times, and yet we'll get back to work and still encounter much of the resistance that we had before. We'll go back to repeating many of the decisions we've done in the past. And so what I want to do is push you to think about the other pathways you could be on. What opportunity lies so close within your path? And maybe for you, that's a bigger role. It might be a new product, a new service, or just a different way of doing things. Innovation can mean a whole wide range of creative change. And we're going to talk about how to actually make it happen. How to recognize those other pathways that are close within your grasp. Now, as you embark upon innovation and chaos, and you think about the ability to change, there are seven traps that we need to talk about and understand. The first is the subtlety of disruptive new ideas. Next, we'll dive into neurological shortcuts and how our brain's high performance can limit our thinking. Then we'll get into the traps that impact successful people. Optionality and the reality that we make fewer big decisions in life than we give ourselves credit for. Next up, we'll dive into linear thinking and how our world might be in a world of exponential change, but our brain fundamentally likes to think in a predictable way. We'll get into the discomfort of trying something new, and we'll wrap up by talking about the ease of inaction. Now, these seven paths are the paths that I call the seven traps of path dependency. The term path dependency is a psychological term that comes to us from the 50s and 60s, and so that part's not revolutionary, but I like to apply it to modern day innovation and chaos because it helps to explain the reality that we stick to the path that we're on. And yet if you could think disruptively, you would better break out of the path that you've been on and be more likely to see the opportunity arising in times of chaos, the new ways to pivot, and ultimately those paths that are so close within your grasp.